We welcome to Papa today, Pastor Craig Harris and his wife, Janie. Wave, Janie. I won't make you stand. Just wave. We are so blessed to have Pastor Craig Harris as the Associate Youth Director for the Michigan Conference. Pathfinders is such an amazing program, and what Pastor Craig has brought to this program is not just all the head knowledge that we learn in the social, the mental, the spiritual aspects of pathfinding, but he really has brought something special about the heart knowledge of getting to know Jesus as our personal Savior. And so it's with great joy that I invite you to our pulpit. And as usual, we have a little gift for you and your wife. So it's filled with assorted goodies from the Pawpaw area. Nice. So I have no idea what's in here, but I know you will be blessed.
Thank you so much. Very good. Well, good morning. It's good to be in. I have never preached in Pawpaw at a church service. That's great. I've been here for investiture. And excuse my congestion, the pre-camp meeting cold gets me every year. And so it's a pleasure to be here. My wife is here, the Women's Ministries Director for Michigan. We're so glad to be here. It was, 3 weeks ago, we were at the in the North Woods of Camp Asable. And we had, what did we have on Saturday night and Sunday morning? We had snow. You guys were working with your bare hands, lashing the little litter to carry that soul and your egg and your flag, and snow was coming down. It was a lot of fun, right? And then we had four baptisms there in Lake Schellenberger on a Sabbath afternoon. And yes, we did wear wetsuits, but that was a blessing. And so greetings from the youth department. We have a lot of fun. Pastor Ken sends his greetings. He is in at summer camp, and they just got done getting everybody, certified all this last week, and horses and lifeguard and the high ropes course. Anybody ever been to Camp Asable at all? All right. I think Kyle is going to be going. You go up tomorrow? Yeah, very good. I appreciate Kyle. I consider him staff. I take him for granted, actually. And so I just want to give a shout out to Kyle. But there's a lot of things. You learn about Jesus in the water at Camp Asable. You can learn about him in land. You can learn about him in nature. You can learn about him on horses. Anybody ever been blobbed at Camp Asable? Anybody out there ever been blobbed? Oh, seriously. You have been, right? Okay, yeah. Anybody, yeah. The blob, yeah, you've been, Pastor. You've been blobbed. I was blobbed by Quentin Purvis and some other big guy I can't remember. Two of them launched me in the air. You know how it is. You lay on one end of a piece of a big, long inner tube, and it's not completely filled up, and two guys stand up on a high tower, jump down on this end, and shoot the unsuspecting. I had no idea how fast you go up in the air. And I went up. I can't say that I enjoyed my fall, because and the landing was worse, because I wasn't doing a tuck like Casey used to do. Could do a little tuck and land on your feet. I landed on my back, better than on my front, but I landed on my back, and that was the last time I'd ever been blobbed. So you can learn about Jesus in the water. I'm not sure how that is, but the most exciting thing about Camp Asable in the water is the baptisms that are there. Young people giving their life to Jesus Christ. Last year alone, it was 258 people gave their lives to Jesus Christ in baptism at Camp Asable. Go figure that, right? I mean, all excited. I'm just beginning. This is an exciting day. Those of you who don't know what Pathfinder, how many of you have ever been a Pathfinder? Raise your hand. Oh, we're full of them here, right? And the Pathfinder ministry is founded on the curriculum. It's called Investiture Achievement. It used to be AY. Remember AY? JMV, right? And so Pathfinder saved it from, from the dumpster in North American Division. North American Division did not see the value of it as South America does and other parts of the country. They still have AOI. North America, for whatever reason, said, yeah, we'll push this out for whatever reason. And Pathfinder says, no way, we're going to save it. And so it's AY is in Pathfinder Ministries. If, Pastor, if everybody here in this sanctuary were to go through the Friend Program, through the Explorer Program, through the Ranger Program, if everybody here would do that, this place would be lit up with disciples for Jesus Christ. And so today, we get a chance to actually remember them, to honor them, to invest them in the time that they've invested. Believe it or not, guys, I was a kid once. You believe that? I'm 54 years old, but I was a kid once. And I didn't always follow the Bible. I didn't accept Jesus as my Savior until I was 16. That's ridiculous. I'd heard about it all of my life, but I never gave my heart to Him until I was 16, way too late. Praise the Lord, I did it. There's a text in the Bible that I didn't heed. I didn't listen to. I'd heard it. Oh, I heard it. But I never really listened and never really applied it. And this Bible text says this. Let's pray. I always want to pray before I read. My dear Heavenly Father, I am so thankful that you gave us your Holy Bible. You gave us your Son Jesus, and you gave us something that you even said is better. I don't know how it can be better than you, but the Holy Spirit, so that we can understand things. And now as I read this scripture, and as we have this special service today, may you be honored and glory and given the glory. In your name I pray, amen. The Bible says, Philippians chapter 2:13, it says this, for it is God, who is it? It's God, who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. The Craig Harris translation is, give your heart to Jesus Christ, tag Jesus, and he will work in you to do things that he would want you to do. Praise the Lord. That's the Craig Harris translation. And then the Bible says this. Uh-oh. So God is in us. We do things according to his plan. That's good news, right? It's really good news. And then the Bible says this. Uh-oh. Do all things without complaining and disputing. I'm not looking at you for any reason there, buddy. Any complainers up here? Don't raise your hand. Any complainers over here? I won't look out there because I know there's complainers out there. Maybe I don't because I haven't never been here. Do all things. Right after Jesus says, it is God who works in you to will and to do according to his good pleasure. Jesus doesn't complain. God doesn't complain. And so he says, with knowing that, don't complain. Do all things without complaining or disputing. Wow. And then he says that you may become blameless. Oh, because when we complain, we blame other people. So he says, don't complain, then you'll be blameless. And then he says, and harmless, because when we dispute, we do a lot of harm. If we argue with one another, we're usually pointing, it's somebody else's fault, right? And so we're harmless. We can do a lot of harm in accusing somebody. And then he goes on, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. Do we live in a crooked and perverse generation? Yes or no? Yes we do. Every time, I don't even listen to the news. I can only take it about once a week, to be honest with you. That's all I can take. I'll turn on, this is to kind of stay current with it, and I'm just, you're kidding me. The mother did what? You're kidding me. They were arguing over that, and so we know in these last days that perilous times are at hand, amen? And Jesus is telling us, hey, I'll work in you in the midst of all of this nastiness that you live in. I'm with you. I didn't understand that. I was 12 years old. I didn't get it. I didn't understand it. I was a good kid. I would be dressed well, but on the inside, I was a complainer. I never complained on the outside. I complained on the inside. Some of you are that same way. Some of you might be too. I don't know. But I was at my grandpa's house on Sabbath afternoon. About 2 or 3 weeks of the month, we'd stay at Grandma and Grandpa's house. And Randy Reese was right next door, and we'd go out in the woods like this, and we'd play hide and seek. And kids, we would have all kinds of fun just doing Sabbath appropriate stuff on Sabbath afternoon. And Grandpa would say, sometimes he'd say, "Let's go for a ride." Now, there's two things when Grandpa says, "Let's go for a ride." One could be, we're going to ride in the back of a white pickup truck. Anybody ever ridden, Pathfinders, have you guys ridden in the back of a pickup truck? A few of you have. How many of you out there have ridden in the back? Oh, man, it is the most cool thing. It's against the law. No, don't say that Pastor Craig said to do this. It's against the law. But I tell you what, it's one of the best things. And so when Grandpa would say, "Let's go for a ride," we're going, "Please have it be the white pickup truck," because we'd get in the back of that white pickup truck, and he had these racks that you could put your ladders on. And if Grandma wasn't looking, we could stand up and hold on to the racks. If Grandma was on, and this is what we had to do. We had Grandpa says, "Let's sit down until we get out of sight of Grandma, and then when we're down the road, you can stand up and hold on tight, though." And so we'd go, "Yes, Grandpa," and we'd wave to Grandma sitting down. "Hi, Grandma." She'd be careful. And we get out there, and Grandpa would knock on the window. "Yes, Grandpa." And we get in that white pickup, and we go up Katy Hill. Katy Hill's the best hill in the world. Because if you go 45 miles an hour in the back of that white pickup, you're going up, and you get airborne. Oh, man. If you're going 44, Grandpa said if you go 44, you don't get it. 45 or greater, you're airborne. And we'd pound on the hood, "Grandpa, yeah, do it again." And sometimes he'd turn around, but most of the time he says, "No," and we'd go. So when Grandpa said, "Let's go for a ride," please let it be the white pickup. But then there's other times when Grandpa says, "Let's go for a ride," we get in the red Impala and we go visit old people. Now I know, who's 12 here? Who's 12? I know you think I'm old. So when I say old, I'm probably talking how old I am, okay? Old is hard when you're 12. It's everybody gets silver hair or no hair or whatever. It's old. And so we would go visit old people. Oh, come on. I never did that to Grandpa. I just, inside I'm going, "Oh, brother." Old people. I'd rather be playing in the woods. And so we get in that red Impala. Grandpa, I remember this, like it was yesterday. Grandpa says, "Let's go." And so we got in the red Impala, pulled out on Marshall Street, turned on Michigan Avenue, which is just down the block. And we turned on Michigan Avenue. I knew who we were going to go see. We're going to go see Mildred. Now, Mildred's got an old name. And Grandma and Grandpa always had Mildred to her house because Mildred didn't have any grandchildren, didn't have any children. And so she was always at our family get-togethers, our Thanksgivings and Christmases. And whenever Mildred would see us, she'd go, "Oh, my, my, my." Whenever she was happy, she'd go, "My, my, my." And so we pulled into Mildred's house, and I'm thinking, "Oh, brother." Oh, one other thing, Mildred, we'd be watching Thanksgiving afternoon, we'd be watching the football game, right? And Mildred, whenever the guys would jump on each other, she'd go, "Oh! Oh, my! My, my, my! Oh!" Every time someone jacked, "Oh!" They're going, "Come on." Well, you know, right? You're 12 years old, you want to watch the game. And we loved Mildred. And so we're going to visit Mildred's house. White house, black shutters, pulled in her driveway. And Grandpa said, "You see what's on Mildred's house?" I looked over there and someone had thrown eggs, 3 eggs, at her house. Well, that's very mean, right? I was a little bit upset. Who would do? And Grandpa asked me, "Do you know who did that?" I didn't know. I kind of had suspicion who did it. And so Grandpa says, well, we're gonna clean that off of her house right now. He told me, you're gonna clean it off. And I remember I'm gonna complain to her on the inside. I love my grandpa. My grandpa loved Jesus with all of his heart. Probably one of the most faithful Christians I've ever known. And Grandpa, he said, we're going to wash that off. And I says, well, Grandpa, it's Sabbath. And he told me something about an ox falling in a ditch. But I don't know. I'm not sure how ox falling in a ditch and eggs in a house relate. But he got the pail out. And I knew that if Grandpa, who's connected to Jesus Christ, said this is something that we're going to need to do. And he says, we need to do this because if we let it stay on there, it's going to stain her house forever. So he brings out the bucket, and then Mildred came out. Oh, my, my, my. She see me. One of the things with Mildred, excuse me, young man, Mildred would just touch our arms. She would just touch our arms. I won't do any more for you. I know that's up. Because I know how annoying it is. And so Mildred, what her hands were so dry. And she just touched her. Oh, my, 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 Craigie. Oh, so good to see. And when you go into her house was like 400 degrees in there. It wasn't that hot because you couldn't survive in there, but it was so hot whenever you went into her house, you just go, oh, no wonder her hands were so dry. Oh, my, my, what are you doing? And I said, I'm going to wash the eggs off. And you could tell it really made her sad that someone had thrown eggs at her house. Craigie, do you know who did it? And I said, I don't know. That was making me mad because who would do that to Mildred? And so I scrubbed that wall. I scrubbed every piece of egg off of that siding. Did a good job. Oh, my, my, my. She ended up, one of the good things about Mildred is she could cook cookies really well. You cook cookies, you bake them. Bake cookies. She could bake cookies really when she knew we were coming, but of course we surprised her today. No cookies. But she always had these candies, and we reluctantly took them. Anybody ever seen those little round white and pink Brocks? They're just little candies that taste like Pepto-Bismol. You just put it in your mouth and you'd go. You wanted to like them, but they were just so bad. And so when she was, here you go, Craigie, thank you so much. And I look at Grandpa and he'd say, take them. And then we'd dispose of them later is what we would do, right? And so she was so thankful, and Grandpa said, hey, Mildred, Grandpa always prayed. Every time he turned around, Grandpa's praying with somebody. And so he says, Mildred, I'm going to have a prayer. And then after we pray, Craig's going to sing. And I looked at my grandpa like, what are you saying? Because you have to understand one thing. I don't sing. Especially when I didn't notice you guys singing. When I was 12 years old, I didn't sing. It wasn't because I couldn't sing. I don't have the best voice in the world. I didn't sing because if Eric Marsh was next to me, or Eric Cooper, or Bobby Blisseth, or Kenny Tiff, if I started singing, they're going to start laughing at me. And that wasn't just in my mind. They would start laughing. Oh, nice voice, Craig. And so I didn't sing. If my friends started singing, guess who would laugh at them? I'd laugh at them. It's ridiculous. That's what young people, I'm not going to look at anybody because I may be stepping on toes. But sometimes young people that don't sing, we don't sing for our friends, we sing for Jesus. And so guys, the girls usually sing. And guys, it's okay if your voice isn't good. And the girls, even if the girls smile at you because you're not singing well, so what? Sing for Jesus. I didn't get that. Well, I looked at Grandpa, sure enough. He said his prayer. I had no idea what song he was talking about me singing. And so he said, now go ahead and sing a song, Craig. And I looked at him in this horror. What song are you talking about? He says, well, the song you like to sing. I don't have a song I like to sing. I didn't say that. I'm in my mind. He says, well, Jesus is the sweetest. Oh, okay. So when my second grade teacher always taught me how to sing in front of people, Jesus is the sweetest name I know, and he's just the same as his holy name, and that's the reason why I love him so, for Jesus is the sweetest name I know. And I was done, and I looked up, and Mildred is crying. And you're right. Oh, my. We laughed. Grandpa said, hey, you sing better than I thought. I'm complaining on the inside. Yeah. But I respected my grandpa so much that I wouldn't. I said, please don't do that again. I loved him so much. I respect him. So I don't know how long it was. 12 years old. You know how everything goes. I'm 54, looking back when I was 12. Who knows how long this took? Grandpa says, go for a ride, and it was in the red Impala again. We were going to the hospital this time. Back when I was a kid, you just didn't go to the hospital. I would imagine, Pathfinders, how many of you have visited someone in the hospital? Yeah, praise the Lord. That's what Pathfinders do now, right? It's just one of the things we do. When I was a kid, you just didn't go to hospitals, unless you were the grandpa. And so we went there and we visited Carl Kidder. He was my junior teacher. Who's the junior teacher here in this class, in this church? Is he here today or she? The junior teacher? No? Be like you think about your junior teacher, right? Mr. Kidder was one of those guys. If the roof needed to be fixed in this church, Mr. Kidder is up there. If someone needed gravel to be spread or the septic tank to be digged up and pumped out, Carl Kidder was the one that would do that. When he's up fixing somebody's roof, he fell off and he broke his back. And he's in the hospital. I'd never been to a hospital. And when I went in and saw Mr. Kidder, he's got stuff all over him. He's in traction. And he's not in good shape. So I was a little nervous. And so whenever Mr. Kidder would see you, he'd say, huh. That's what he'd see at church. He'd just go, huh. It's kind of a sound. And we walked in, you hear this from all of underneath all of these tubes and stuff. Huh. And then you say, Gene, just like an angel walked in. And I went on one side of the bed and Grandpa's on the other side of the bed. And we talked and Grandpa's talking Carl out of quit worrying about fixing people's houses because the other church members are going to take care of it. And then Grandpa says, we're going to have a prayer with you, Carl. I'm going to pray, and Craig's going to pray. What? I don't pray. Remember, I'm 12 years old, and I know how to pray, but I don't know how to pray. And I'm scared to death to pray in front of my junior teacher. I probably did it. I don't even remember. I don't even remember how many prayers, because all my prayers were just surface prayers. And then he says, then Craig is going to sing. And I looked at him with that look, and he gave me a smirk, and I smirked to him. But the singing part was fine. The prayer part was the one I was really having a tough time with. Because I didn't have a relationship with Jesus. I didn't. I knew who he was. I didn't have a relationship with him. I didn't have a prayer life with him. And so when my grandpa is, we're holding hands. I'm holding Mr. Kidder's hand. I'm holding my grandpa's hand. Kind of awkward. But we're doing that, and Grandpa's praying. And you know what I'm praying while my grandpa's praying? This is a prayer. I remember it's the most sincere prayer I ever had up to that point in my life. Dear Jesus, help me to pray a good prayer. Dear Jesus, please help me to pray a good prayer. You know what you do, young people, Pathfinders, adults? If you don't know how to pray, you know what you do? You pray. Seems weird. It seems like the opposite. When you don't know how to pray, you get on your knees and say, Dear Heavenly Father, you know I don't know how to pray to you. Please help me to know how to pray to you. And when it was all done, Grandpa said, Amen. I don't know what I said. All I remember saying was, In Jesus' name, Amen, because I was taught to say that. And I said that, and phew, I'm done. Mr. Kidder wouldn't let go of my hand. My grandpa wouldn't let go of my hand. I'm thinking, okay, guys, my prayer's done. And they're just, and Mr. Kidder squeezed my hand, and my grandpa squeezed my hand. I'm thinking, oh, come on, guys. And then they released, and I looked at Mr. Kidder, and he was crying. And so Grandpa said, why don't you go ahead and sing now? I think, brother. Singing in a hospital room to my junior teacher. And my junior teacher said, I didn't know you sang. He'd never heard me sing before. Jesus is the sweetest name I know, and he's just the same as his holy name. And that's the reason why I love him so. For Jesus is the sweetest name I know. I'm done singing, and I look at Mr. Kidder, and he's really crying. I look at my grandpa, and he's crying. Every time I sing, people cry. Surprised you guys didn't break out in tears. We went back out to the car, and I remember it was yesterday, and Grandpa, normally Grandpa's all business, he hops in there, fire that Impala up, and he just sat there for a little bit. He says, you know, that was a really, really good prayer, and your song was even better. I didn't know what was hitting me back then. Got a guy named Gene Harris who took his Bible very, very serious. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. That's even for 12-year-olds who don't know how to sing. That's for all of you that think you don't have what it takes. God works in you to will and to do to his good pleasure. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may be... Yep, I lost my train of thought here. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless. Wouldn't it be good to have a harmless household? I'm going to look straight ahead again here because I don't know your households here. I was in Cadillac one time and I was preaching, and the Lord brought to me, I was going off on some sins, some secret sins, and I said the word, and you might be smoking weed. And I never even used that word. And as soon as it came out of my mouth, I'm going, what? What am I doing that for? And later on, we're shaking hands out there, and the guy says, you know, don't you? And I said, I know what? He says, you know. I says, I know what? You know. I says, I don't know. And he whispered, you know that I'm smoking marijuana. I says, I didn't know. He says, you looked right at me when you said smoking weed. I says, let's talk afterwards. We did. I showed him my notes, and I showed him what was in there. He says, I don't even use that word. He says, I know, Pastor. Why did you look right at me, though? I said, why do you think? He says, the Holy Spirit? I says, that's right. And so when I'm talking, and I look at the wall or at the floor, I don't know. But you do, right? I don't know, complainers. I don't know what your home life is like. Pathfinders, I don't know what's in your mind. I don't know what's going on, but I know that Jesus does. Jesus loves you. Do all things that you may be blameless and harmless, children of God without fault. Don't you want to be a child of God without fault? Amen? It's a promise right here in the Bible, Philippians. Without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. Whoa. That's today. And then it says, you will shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Even over at Mildred's house, I'm going to let it shine, let it shine. Going to see Mr. Kid. You know, here, I'm winging this one here. Oh, man, that's exciting. Grandpa would call himself a tipper-upper. I don't know what in the world is it? Grandpa had a lot of cool sayings, right? He'd hit his thumb with a, he was a blacksmith kind of guy, and he taught me how to weld. He pounded his thumb one time, and I've been around people that hit their thumb before, and I've heard him say words that you're not supposed to say. Grandpa would go, "Oh, man." And I'm going, "Oh." He says, "That makes me so mad that I could eat fried chicken, Craig." And I remember as I was 15 or 16 years old, I said, "That is just so cool." And so Grandpa says, "We're tipper-uppers." Man, I'm thinking, what? He says, "Well, we go over to, when we went over to Mildred's house, Mildred's been tipped over. People threw eggs at her house. And so the devil likes to tip people over. And so God uses a guy like Gene Harris, pulls his grandson along to pray and to clean up her house and basically just to tip her back up. He uses, you know, a 12-year-old in a hospital room where you're not really supposed to be and someone's been tipped over. Devil does good business of tipping people over. But Jesus is in the business of using you, Pathfinders, you young people, you old people. You noticed I looked up, to be tipper-uppers, being a light in a crooked and perverse generation. You can't do it. God can. God can. That's so exciting. Tipper-upper. You guys want to be a tipper-upper? Yeah. It's easy. It's hard, but it's easy. It's simple, but it's hard. Whoa. Doesn't make any sense, Pastor Craig. Yes, it does. It's hard because we have to get over ourselves. It's easy because Jesus says, "I'll do it for you." Yeah. Wow. Praise God. Yeah. So, here we go. Investiture. Again, I have the best job in the entire world. I'm the Michigan Pathfinder and Adventurer Director. All year long, I do fun stuff, but these months, the March, April, May, and June, not March, April, May, and June, I travel around Michigan, and this is what fills my cup. I'm pretty lonely in the office. I kind of went to the conference office kicking and screaming a little bit because I love the local church. I love the local church ministry. And so I'm so thankful to be able to come and recognize you guys for what you've done. That's pretty exciting stuff. You're going to get some badges and some awards today. Not awards. You're going to be getting your honors and your pins today. And oh, those are good. Did you guys know one thing? I see your sashes here. And you got some nice honors on there, young man. You got some nice honors. You got your CPR honor and your first aid. You got Adonates and a lot of cool stuff. Do you realize, guys, that when Jesus comes, everything burns up, right? We know that. Except for one thing. Your Pathfinder sash. Obviously, you're on to me that I'm just kidding, right? But I'm not. You tell you what, all of those things in that sash, every single one of those things, whether it's cattails, whether it's animal tracking, has taught you something about Jesus Christ. Hopefully something sunk in because all of those honors are building your character. Guess what goes to heaven? Your character does. A bunch of characters won't be up there. Well, I guess so. If we're there, we're going to be there. But these honors, the reason why you have these honors is not to have cool stuff that burns, it's to develop our character. Wow. That's why I love Pathfinders. It's exciting. And there are different levels of Pathfindering, and today in your church, we're going to be able to honor, reward, invest three master guides. Isn't that exciting? One of them happens to be your pastor. And I love the fact that there are pastors such as your own that invest time and effort into being best that they can be for young people, developing young people. So I'm going to turn the time over here to you. Pathfinders, when you come up and receive your awards, I understand we're not pinning, right? We're just going to be receiving them. When you shake people's hands, you're going to shake hands with confidence, not with a wimp. That's there, stronger, just like that. Because you're going to be going for a job interview someday, and you're not going to go up and say, I'd like to work for you at the veterinary clinic. No, you're going to go through, I'd like to work in your veterinary clinic, okay? So we're going to do that. We're going to practice today. If you don't do it, you don't get your envelope until you do it, okay? Deal? And it's no pressure, just do it. It's easy, right? It's easy. All right.
Very good. So it is truly an amazing thing. The Master Guide program is at least a 2-year program. I know that for at least one of our Master Guides, she started it in the 1970s. And so she was involved in Pathfinder ministry with her husband for many years at Battle Creek Tabernacle, with our Battle Creek Pioneers, and she finished her Master Guide requirements as the tutor for Joshua Velez. So I would like Verda Slack and Josh Velez and Pastor Taylor to come forward, and Chris is also going to help us with investing today.
This is the highest level of achievement within the youth ministries of the World Church. You are receiving this because of your diligence to the young people and hours of training. And so it's our pleasure to be able to invest you at this time as Master Guides. You can redo this. Pleasure to be able to do this. There's not very many pastors in this world
that have
received this. So wherever you go in this world, you'll be a Master Guide. It's a high expectation, though, that you continue to hold this high standard wherever you go. Take your pin. I'll go ahead and pin you. I'm going to go right up on top of the button here. You can adjust it later. It's a bit the highest
spot. And you get a new
spot. Okay.
For your shirt.
You know me, I put this right on the sash, but it's okay. There you go. Congratulations.
I'm going to ask our new Master Guides to stay up here to help us shake hands. And I have one more very special award that we don't often see at the local church, but I wanted to share that with you today. So Kyle, would you please come forward? You'll notice there are a few of us that have red braids. These braids signify the involvement in the teen leadership training program that Pathfinders offers. We've been very blessed to have a couple of Pathfinders achieve all 4 years of TLT. Kate did that a few years ago, and she has been a fantastic member of our team. And today, we give Kyle his 4-year pin. He is completing the program.
Put on your scarf. I'll have you close it. I'll have you go this way. They don't want to see my backside. In this world of 8 billion people, Kyle, there's only a handful that have ever received four-year TOT, so appreciate you. God bless. The TLT program is a program that is recognized around the world. That's a teen leader in training. They're not perfect people, but they're, how many of you are perfect as a leader? None of us, right? Sometimes our teens get a raw deal. When they try to do something and they don't do very well, the people say they can't do it, they're too young. And so this teen leadership program is a program that helps in a safe environment to develop their leadership skills. Recognized by the world, he happens to be stationed here in Pawpaw, Michigan. So thank you. We have over 200. We're the third largest in North American division for our TLT program. So.
All right, now it's time for all the rest of you. We have had a very busy and full Pathfinder year, but I'm not going to bore you with all the details. But I invite you, if you are a fourth grader that has just become a fifth grader, to come see us in August when we have our registration event, and we'll tell you all about the really cool things we do in Pathfindering that help you get all of these cool things for our sash that won't burn up. All right. Riley Bergman has completed the Friend class.
Riley, congratulations, honey. Very proud of you. Very proud of you. Do you have to shake the Master Guide's hands?
Addison Randall also has completed the Friend class.
Addison, I'm so proud of you, honey. Very good. You can go ahead and sit down.
Jacob Alenko.
You can shake their hands, but then go on. When you come up, make sure you
Jacob has completed the companion class.
Go ahead and shake their hands. I know it's confusing.
The next class is Explorers. It's our seventh grade. It is our very largest class, and I want to give a shout out to our teacher, Michelle Seeley, because she had her hands full with all the energy in the room. It's with great pride I invite you all up here. Brandon Bledsaw. Chelsea Bodai. Suvan Campbell. Not with us today was Ian Mascara. I understand he may have hurt himself. Brandon McQuada.
Good job, Brandon. Proud of you, buddy.
Our next class is the Ranger class, eighth graders. We had a healthy number of them as well. Solana Campbell.
Solana, congratulations. You need to get TLT next year.
Not with us today because he's visiting grandparents, Malachi Dyson. Zach West.
Zach, job, buddy. Funny.
In addition to teaching the Explorer class, Master Guide Michelle Seeley has also been working to be invested as a Voyager. Congratulations.
Thanks so much for your leadership.
We have some additional mentions for the honors that they have either taught or received as staff. In addition to Master Guide, one of the requirements is church heritage, so Verda gets this patch as well. Pastor Taylor gets a bunch. I've never seen anybody quite so excited about putting patches on the uniform. I kid you not, first camperee, totally blank sash. He's telling me about an honor he earned. I said, I think I have that in my kit. Sure enough, he had needle and thread with him right there at the camp out. First honor on.
Nice.
And we also want to invite Andrea up. She taught the digital photography honor this year.
Thanks, Andrea.
I wish I had the patches for the last one I'm going to specify, which was our pizza-making honor. Would you guys like to guess who might have taught that? You are so right. It was Joe Sarcona. It was by far the favorite honor that the kids did this year. We appreciate it. And when the patches are off back order, you will all get those. So thank you, Joe. I am so proud of these young people. They have learned so much. In addition to the things that go on their sash, we have had a very active Share Your Faith program this year. One of the more recent things, you might hear the kids talking about their toy stories and getting prizes from the toy box. TOY stands for Think Outside Yourself. So not only are we doing orchestrated events where we go someplace, we go see someone who has, you know, been ill, or we go do singing, or pass out steps to Christ, or all the different things that we do in Share Your Faith, they're also learning in every aspect of their lives, every day-to-day activity of their lives, to think outside themselves and to lead others to Jesus. And that truly is what pathfindering is all about. Amen. And so thank you for sharing your young people with me this year. I've enjoyed every moment of them, and it's a blessing that when you serve, you are served more than you could ever imagine. So thank you.
As Heather's coming forward here, one of the things that I wanted to celebrate, Heather, come on forward. One of the things I did want to celebrate is it's more than just the patches and things like that. What really excites me is to see people make decisions for Jesus. And so it's really neat that I have the opportunity to study with five of our Pathfinders who are currently preparing for baptism. And so it's just really exciting to have young people who have given their life to Jesus Christ and to be a part of that opportunity. And it takes a lot of effort and a lot of dedication, and so Heather here is going to talk a little bit about some of the effort and dedication, and we can show some appreciation to someone who really deserves it.
Thank you. Well, Cheryl, we don't have an award or a badge or a patch to give you today, but the parents really want to thank you for all the time that you put into our kids. The hours that you could be doing something else at home with your family, with your granddaughter now. We do appreciate all of what you do.
Thank you.
We appreciate the other leaders, Caitlin, Michelle, Bonnie. And I know that there's other parents who have gone on the camping trips, who have spent time away from the home. Our kids love you, and they appreciate you, and we want to thank you.
Thank you. All the time I spend in Pathfinders, I couldn't do it if it weren't for the steady support of my husband, who stays home and does the laundry on Sundays when I'm gone. So thank you, John.
I'm going to have the Pathfinders stand. Attention, please. Congregation, please stand. Pathfinders, parade rest. Prayer attention. My dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for this Sabbath day that you've given to us. What a blessing you are to us in giving this day. We're so thankful for your Holy Spirit that has been with us today as well, and your Holy Bible, the word that can teach us and find good spots in our soil, in our soils of our heart. I pray, Lord, as we leave this place today, that every place that we step our foot would be for your sake and conquering new territory for you. I pray for these Pathfinders and the staff, that as they continue to dedicate their life to you, that you would continue to bless them indeed. We pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Pathfinders, ten, huh? As you were.
I invite you to sit for a moment. We have a special number prepared, and then as they finish, you are welcome to go to the narthex and mingle.
Thank you.